Good morning. We just want to welcome everybody out today. I saw Jeff. Jeff's ready. In the back, I saw that thing going on. I said, I got a show back here. Jeff's ready. We just want to thank you all for coming out. If you are a guest with us today, we would love to give you a gift. We just need you to grab the Connect card that's in front of you in the seat pocket, fill it out, and take it over to the welcome desk, and we will just have an appreciation gift for you. The worship team is going to lead us in worship. After that, we will dismiss our kids to Kid Zone. That's for kids fifth grade and under. And then we will have Pastor Kelly. He is going to come and he is going to share a message with us. And I do just want to, again, draw your attention to a couple of things. I made a post on our In the Know, but we have some free books just outside this door. And those are for you and your family as tools, as things that can help you. But there's several, so that if you want to reach out and you want to evangelize, if you want to share Christ and you're not sure how to do that, we have several books that can help you do that. They're just small. They're easy to read. So we want you guys to feel free to take however many that you want. And just so you'll know, the life book out there is kind of student oriented. So if you have, you know, students in your family and your life and, you know, coworkers, and you want to share that. We have the Jesus story for teens and adults. We also have Equipped. Now, what Equipped is, it's by Covenant Eyes. And we know that pornography is rampant in our society. And if you don't know how to prepare your kids, your young kids, your teens, yourselves, that is a great tool to help you know what to watch for, how to talk about things. So if you want that one, we have that one out there. So it's just outside in this black, what is that? She's holding them up right there. Brittany's got them. So it's on this black glass counter, and we want you guys to feel free to take those. And then on the back, we've just got a couple of new groups that are starting, and we just want you to take note of those, as well as all the things that are currently happening through the week. We just want to equip you to serve God and each other, and these are some ways that we do that. So we just welcome you this morning, and we just ask you to worship the Lord.
If you all would stand with us this morning. You know, throughout the Bible, it talks about praise. You know, this first song, it talks about praise and praising the King. And throughout this song, it talks about the good stuff where you can praise Him for certain things. But this morning, I want you to think about praising Him when you don't think you can. Praising Him when your week's been hard or your day's been hard. Because no matter what we do in life, we need to praise our King. We need to praise Him on the mountaintop. We need to praise Him in the valley. And we need to praise Him when we don't think we can. So sing with us and praise Him this morning. Praise Him in the morning for tall and lofty trees, and praise Him in the evening for children on their knees. And praise Him in the noonday for gentle birds that sing. And praise Him, all ye people, praise the King. And praise Him for the peaceful porch and rocking chairs that sway. And praise Him for those rolling hills where our children laugh and play. And praise Him for that wandering soul that never lost his way. And praise Him, all ye people, praise our King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. And praise Him for the blood that fell and bloomed a rose that day. and praise Him that He suffered through grief, the guilt, the shame, and praise Him that His tender love still forgives today, and praise Him, all ye people.
Last two scripture of that chapter tells us, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting."
Shield my way. worship and praise him this morning because he promised he'd never leave me nor forsake me. He truly is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. He says in Deuteronomy 31:8, "The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged."
You've been healing.
price of that. Lord, it just seems like sometimes life gets so hard, it gets so heavy, we get so discouraged that we forget that you're there. Lord, we lean on our own knowledge, our own abilities to take care of things. And Father, I'm praying for those who are struggling. It just seems like right now we have so many people around us who are struggling in different ways, in different areas of their lives. And I'm praying that you would first of all remind us that you are there, that you are faithful, and that you are a loving God. And Father, I'm praying that you would help us to be your hands and that we would be your feet, that we would have a desire to help and to encourage other people. So Father, I pray that you are glorified in this service today. Help us to look to you through the truth of your word so that we can become more like you and impact people for the kingdom of God. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Before we dismiss the kids to Kids Zone, just want to remind you guys, if you would, to just take a minute. We do have handouts kind of sitting around, and I do want to draw your attention, leaders, that we're going to have our next leadership training on March the 7th. So March the 7th, I know that we informed you guys of that at our last leadership training. So that's going to be on March the 7th. So with that, we're going to go ahead and dis our kids to Kids Zone. These are classes that we have for students up to the fifth grade. If you want your children to go, they can. If you want them to hang out here with us, that's fine as well. Okay, I don't know if I'm supposed to do something with that. Okay, you do have some sermon notes if you're interested in that. We're continuing with our Unsung Hero series, and you know, I've just really been thinking as I was praying and studying over this week, I have never seen a time in our society where people are as broken as what they are right now. Would you agree with that? I've never seen a time when they are as broken, when they are as depressed as what they are right now. They're desperate and they're struggling. And what we see is that they struggle in different ways. I don't even mean to say they, but we're struggling in different ways, that we are struggling with mental health. And so many people that you talk to, and so many of the healthcare professionals that are dealing with mental health are talking about how they're seeing more cases and dealing with more people in the last year than they have in a decade. And so what's going on around us is having a huge impact. I know I've talked to educators, and they're talking about just the mental state of their students and how they're concerned about that. All of this really boils down. There definitely is a physical aspect to this. Let me just be clear. Never, ever, ever have I said that this thing and this virus is not real. It is, and there's real effects, and it's impacting people. But all this boils down to spiritual impact. And with that being said, I think that we are desperate. Hey, Cam, I need your help. Would you get in my bag back there and get my glasses? I'm realizing I don't have them up here. Laugh again. That's strike two on you. They're in the big section. I was looking up here. I thought y'all done played a trick on me. Then I thought, nope, it's me this time. So Ethan is, he loves being in front of people. He loves this so much. Thank you, sir. Huh? No, I don't need the sparkly ones. These are fine right here. Okay. So anyway, people are desperate for a hero. Amen. I hope you understand this. I hope you understand this, that people are desperate for a hero. And when I think of people, and when I think of people needing a hero and somebody that's a hero in the faith, I automatically think of a certain chapter of Scripture. Anybody have an idea maybe where I'm headed? If we're talking about giants in the faith, the Hall of Fame for the faithful. Anybody? Hebrews 11, very good. Yes, Hebrews 11, you're right. So I'm going to look at Hebrews 11. And when I look through this, to me, it truly is the Hall of Fame. So those of you who are sports fans, they have different halls of fame for different sports. And so if you were in the Faithful Hall of Fame, you would be mentioned here in Hebrews chapter 11. And what I'm going to do is not read the entire chapter to you. I just want to find some names here in Hebrews chapter 11. The first name that is mentioned is found in verse 4, and it says, "It was by faith that Abel," is our first name, "brought a more acceptable offering to God." In verse 5, it says, "It was by faith that Enoch was taken up to heaven without dying. He was known as a person who pleased God." Verse 7, "It was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family." Verse 8, "It was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land." It talks about Sarah in verse 11. "It was by faith that even when Sarah was not able to have a child, that she believed and that God would keep his promise." As I start to see some of these names, you know what I realize? The things that are mentioned about them, the things that find them in Hebrews chapter 11, I'm just being honest, they don't really seem like that big of a deal. I mean, the first one that's mentioned here, he's mentioned because he had a better offering than his brother. So because of that, God led somebody, the writer of Hebrews, to place him in Hebrews. Enoch was taken up without dying. That is a big deal. I mean, I think that's maybe an exception. That's a pretty big one. But he was just known as a person that pleased God. Now, Noah, yes, he spent hundreds of years building a large boat, but he did it to save his family. Listen, I know people, you're going to do anything in your power to save your family and to take care of your family. Amen? Am I in the right church? So what I'm seeing here is that these people are ordinary people who are doing ordinary things. But please realize that before it mentions their name, it says that it was by faith that they did these things. Abraham, it was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to go to another land. I know of people who are moving and they're going here and they're going there and they pray about these decisions. Here's what I think God wants us to understand in Hebrews 11. It doesn't take this special Navy SEAL of a faithful person to be found faithful in serving God. I want you to get this and I want you to understand this. These are just ordinary people. And if I had the time, I could go through here and point out to you, most of these people, they had faults. Most of these people, they had failures in their life that you and I could point to and say, oh my gosh, they're not perfect. And here's what we understand. None of these people are perfect, but they lived a life of faith. And because they lived a life of faith, to us, they are heroes of the faith. It goes on here to talk about Isaac, it says, it was by faith that Isaac promised blessings to his future sons. Now, I'm just telling you, as a dad, I don't know of any good dad who wouldn't do what he could to bless his children. Amen? And God found him faithful enough because he wanted to bless his children that he was found worthy enough to be placed in Hebrews chapter 11. It says the same thing about Jacob. It says, it was by faith, verse 21, that when Jacob was old, that he blessed Joseph's sons. Listen, I don't know of any grandparent who doesn't do everything they can to bless their grandkids. Amen. Some of you to the point of spoiling, different sermon altogether. I'll do my best to back up on that right now because I just feel the lack of love coming from you. But here, he's found faithful enough to be in Hebrews chapter 11 because he spoke a blessing over his grandsons. It says that it was by faith that Joseph said that Israel was going to leave Egypt. So because he prophesied that Israel, who are God's people, are going to leave Egypt, that they found him faithful enough to be there. I'd really like to hang out here, but the Holy Spirit won't let me. I really want to just get up on a soapbox and drive a stake in the ground. Verse 23, it was by faith that Moses' parents hid him for 3 months. And they were not afraid to disobey the king's command. Let me tell you something right now. You are to obey God more than you are to obey man. And Moses' parents looked at the face of this stupid edict that the king put out and said, no, I'm not going to follow that. My kids are more important. My family is more important. And I'm going to do what God leads me to do before I do what you tell me to do. And because of that, Moses ended up having life. He ended up being very, very influential in saving God's people. And I will just kind of leave that right there and let that marinate in your spirit is my prayer. But you and I need to follow God more than we follow men. Amen. Amen. And it goes on here to talk about verse 31. I feel sorry, honestly, for her. Verse 31, this is what is recorded in Scripture, okay? It was by faith that Rahab the prostitute was not destroyed with the people of her city. I mean, come on. Can we not have left that detail out? You with me? I mean, we're talking about Scripture. This woman was found faithful enough to be in Hebrews chapter 11. However, they decided to put that little detail in there. Now, if I were her, I'd be like, hey, can we leave out that one detail? I mean, I'm okay with being known, and I know that. And what she did was she protected the spies when they came into Jericho, but she is known that way. Let me just stop for just a second. Some of these people, I won't go into their history, but a lot of these men, and even this woman who is now mentioned, were not perfect people. I want you to get me. They weren't perfect. They made mistakes. They fell. Some of them fell in great ways, and yet they were found worthy enough to be in Hebrews chapter 11. The enemy wants you to think that you're not that person, that it's the preacher's job, that it's the pastor's job, it's this leader's job. You need to know these are ordinary people, and it was by faith that they did normal things. They wanted to bless their children. They just decided to follow what God led them to do and to go from this place to another place, and that they were willing to help people and to encourage people. And because of that, they're found in the faithful hall of fame. You and I need to do the same thing. We need to realize that you don't have to be a Billy Graham or a T.D. Jakes to do things for the kingdom of God. It goes on here to mention a list of people, and it's going to kind of be where we focus, but in verse 32 it says, how much more do I need to say? It would take too long to recount the stories of faith of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and all the prophets. Now here's what I want to do. I want to give you the results of faith. This is so important. I'm going to be in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 33 through the start of verse 35, and this gives us the results of faith. And when I look over this scripture, I realize that our society is desperate for somebody to have a faith like this, because we need these types of results. Verse 33, by faith, these people overthrew kingdoms. Preach. I don't like getting political, but I'm telling you right now, it seems like we get more ungodly and more ungodly every day. It's time that Christians realize we need to have a voice, we need to speak up, and we need to represent the God who saved us. Quit being so shy. Quit thinking that Christians need to just sit down and take the beatings that the world wants to give us. You have a wonderful message. Let somebody hear it. And we need to vote our faith. It says it was by faith that they overthrew kingdoms. They ruled with justice. They received what God promised them. They shut the mouths of lions and quenched the flames of fire and escaped death by the edge of the sword. I want you to get this. Their weakness was turned to strength. They became strong in battle. They put whole armies to flight. Here's what you need to understand. They weren't strong before the fight. They became strong through the battle. So many of us are weak spiritually. We're weak mentally right now, and I'm not knocking you for that. But what we see is that these giants in the faith became strong through the battle. You see, we want that strength. Man, we want that testimony. We just don't want to live it. Amen. We don't want to live through the crap that we got to live through to get to the place that we've got that strength, to get to the place that we've got that testimony. So we see here the results of faith. And I'm telling you, society needs some of these results. We need to shut the mouths of lions. We need to quench some fiery trials that people are going through. Amen. It's what people need, but here's what I want to do. As I mention that, there are two names that are mentioned there that honestly, I don't think hardly anybody knows anything about them. And so what I want to do is I want to bring up these people. It mentions here in verse 32, two names, and we're going to focus on them today. One is Barak, and the other is Jephthah. And so I'm going to take a minute, and so I'm going to go over Jephthah first, just because this is something that is very important. I'm going to be honest. It's going to lead you to ask some questions. Listen to me right now. This section of Scripture is going to lead you to ask some questions, and those are questions that I can't answer because I think this guy did something stupid. And even though he did something stupid, and I don't really think that God had ordained him to do it, but once he did something stupid, he did something else that was very hero of the faith-ish. And because of that, we find him in Hebrews chapter 11. But what I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk about some tag team heroes. Tag team heroes. And when I was a kid, we had like 4 TV stations. Now, some of you, I sound so old. I'm telling you. I've never been one of them to tell my kids, when I was in school, I walked a hill, uphill, all the way there and all the way back, and it snowed every day. And I know how some of you old people are, and y'all tell that story. I walked 6 miles. By the way, I did walk to school in grade school. But I had 4 TV stations when I was a remote. I've shared that with y'all before, right? Anybody else? Were you the remote control? Here was mine. That meant turn the channel. And I'm like, he went through it twice. I'm like, dude, you got 4 channels. It's not that. One of the stations that we had was the Turner Broadcasting Network, and they played the Atlanta Braves, which is why I like the Braves. Plus, they had Dale Murphy. He was the only Mormon dude that I knew that was famous, and so you got to root for that guy. And then they showed wrestling. Okay? Oh, don't judge me. Okay. And what I remember about wrestling, other than us acting out wrestling and getting my butt kicked by my older brother all the time, I remember tag team wrestling. Anybody else? Tag team wrestling. And so I even went back and I started doing a little bit of research. The Road Warriors. Anybody y'all? Y'all remember the Road Warriors? Oh, y'all won't admit it. Some of you do. Rock and Roll Express. Huh? Long blonde hair. Yeah. Some of you girls are like, oh, they're so cute. Oh, I remember them. They'd hop over the top rope. Rock and Roll Express. The Steiner Brothers. Back before they lost their minds. The British Bulldogs. But here's what I remember. Here's what I remember about tag team wrestling. You would have two people in the middle of the ring out here, and one would just be beating the crap out of the other one, and you'd have the other one leaning over the rope like, oh, come on, man, just tag me in. Oh, just tag me in. Tag me in. Anybody? Y'all remembering this? Come on, y'all, leave me out here on a rope. They'd be leaning over. Oh, they were just getting tore up, getting beat up all like crazy in the middle of the ring. But if they got to the point that they did that stupid looking flip flop and they got over there and they tagged their partner, that person would come in and they'd be, you ever notice how they have to stomp when they punch? I don't want to ruin it for you, but they're not really hitting them. Just saying, okay. So they come in and man, once they'd hit them 88 times in 2 seconds. I mean, it was impressive. Here's what happened. Once they made the tag, the person that was getting their butt kicked ends up getting some help and some support, and then the tide changes, and then the momentum shifts. And here's what God wants you to understand. We read about some heroes in the Bible that are tag team heroes, that when one is struggling, the other is just waiting. And when they do, when they reach out and they get that tag, we start to see some victory, and we start to see some success. So I'm going to preach to you about some tag team heroes. And some of y'all got this wrestling image in your head, and I'm going to lose you, but it's going to be okay. So before I get into the tag team heroes, I want to share with you about Jephthah. And I'm just curious, how many of you are familiar with Jephthah? He's found in Hebrews 11. Okay. I read Hebrews 11. I'd preached for a long time, and I thought, I don't know who this guy is. And I don't know why he's there. But would you agree, those of you that understand Scripture, if he's in Hebrews 11, he did something pretty substantial with his faith. Amen? So let's figure out about Jephthah. He's found in Judges chapter 11. Judges chapter 11. And I love that God kind of inspired whoever wrote Hebrews to put certain people in there. When we learn about Jephthah, we figure out he was not a typical churchy boy. I'll just share with you in Judges chapter 11. His mother was a prostitute. Now, here's the issue with that. His dad, Gilead, had another family. You with me? So his dad had other children. So then dad one day is like, I probably need to tell you, I got another son. And they brought him in, and this might shock you, but his other sons, his half-brother, said, no, this ain't going to work. And they ran him out of town. They ran him out of the house. The Bible does not, you know, state for us at what age he was. But here he was. He was the son of a prostitute. And his dad's trying to bring him in because it's his son. He's trying to take care of him. And his brothers ran him out. They said, oh, no. You're not getting part of the inheritance. You're not part of this family. So they kick him out. He was unwanted. The Bible records for us that he ran around with a bunch of hoodlums and rebels, it says in New Living Translation. It says that he ran around with a bunch of rebels. I mean, you can imagine the only thing that he could do to survive was to just be rough. But it says that he was also a great warrior. And you see, when life is so hard on you, the only way that you can survive is by fighting. And I'm not saying that everything he did was right. And I think it's pretty clear that he did a lot of wrong things. But what we see here is that life made him hard. Life made him tough. Listen to me right now. Some of you, life's been tough. Some of you, life has been hard on you. And you've been raised in situations, and you have dealt with situations. And some of you, man, I'm trying really hard not to point people out, but I think about some of you in the last couple of weeks that you've had, and oh my goodness, most people, it would just devastate them. And the fact that you are here today, and that you're still in God's church, and you're still around God's people, just shows to me that you are giants in the faith, even when you don't realize it. And you're just coming, and you're just trying. You see, other people see you as giants in the faith. That's the thing about these Hebrews 11 type people. They didn't realize they were giants in the faith. They were just living their life in front of people. We're talking about being a hero to people that are desperate for a hero. So here's Jephthah. His mom's a prostitute. His half-brothers run him out of town. His dad doesn't have anything to do with him. He's running around with a bunch of hoodlums. But here's what happens. The Israelites get attacked by the Amorites. And basically, the Israelites know they're getting ready to take a butt kicking. And so they call. The Israelite leaders call Jephthah, and they're like, hey, we need you to come help us. Now, I'm just telling you how I would react. I'd be thinking something like this. You mean to tell me I'm not good around to hang out with y'all? I'm not good enough to spend time with y'all? But here now, just because I can beat up a lot of people, now just because you can see some good coming from me, now because you get yourself in trouble, now you want to come to me? I'm not going to ask how many of us would just leave him there to suffer, but I would say perhaps some of us would do that. So Jephthah decides that he's going to go ahead and get involved with this. So the Israelite leaders make him this promise, and so they go to him. And so then the point that I want you to see is here is Jephthah, and he's leading the Israelite armies, and they're going into battle. And here's what the part that I want you to see. It says in Judges chapter 11, Judges chapter 11, Jephthah makes a vow in verse 30. This is our main point here for Jephthah. He makes a vow in verse 30. And Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. He said, if you give me victory over the Ammonites, I will give to the Lord whatever comes out of my house to meet me when I return in triumph. I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. Let me read that one more time. Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. He said, if you give me victory over the Ammonites, I will give to the Lord whatever comes out of my house to meet me when I return in triumph. I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. Now, I have no idea why he did this. I don't understand what he's thinking, and I'll be truthful, I don't agree with what he did. I think it was a mistake. But for whatever reason, he did this. He made a vow. Here's the part you need to understand. Jephthah made a vow. Verse 32. So Jephthah led his army against the Ammonites, and the Lord gave him victory. He crushed the Ammonites, devastating about 20 towns. So I want you to hear me. This isn't just a small victory. He devastated them. 20 towns he went and he destroyed. God gave him a victory that was huge. It was bigger than anything that we could comprehend, and it made a huge impact for the Israelites. You with me? So here he is, this thug of a guy, this child of a prostitute that nobody wanted. By the way, let me tell you, when people get desperate enough, they'll overlook your past and focus on just what you have to offer. Let me say that again. When people are so broken, when people are so desperate, they will ignore your past. They'll ignore your mistakes, and they'll just focus on the things that you can do to help them and to benefit them. You see, Jephthah was not a perfect guy. He didn't have a perfect past. He obviously didn't have a perfect family tree, but there came a time when people needed him, and he was ready to help them. You see, that's what we need to do. For us, we need to be ready to jump in and help people. You don't have to be perfect. I mean, we are to strive for perfection. This is not me saying, hey, go out and live any way you want to. But we are to strive for perfection. But over and over in Hebrews 11, we see men and we see women who were not perfect. But here, God gave them a great victory that day. However, verse 34, when Jephthah returned home, his daughter came out to meet him, playing on a tambourine and dancing with joy. She was his one and only child. Now, I don't know what he was thinking when he made that vow. The only thing I can think is he was willing to sacrifice his cat. That's a cat. You know what I mean? Okay, I'll leave that alone. Some of you like cats. I'll leave that right there. The Bible is not clear. And so here's what I want to share with you. Although, remember when I told you you're going to have some questions and I'm not going to be able to answer them and some stuff may not make sense to you? This is that part of that right here. So his daughter comes out to meet him and he tells her, you have devastated me. You have devastated me. And he goes on to say here in verse 35, he says, for I have made a vow to the Lord and I cannot take it back. I've made a vow to the Lord and I cannot take it back. Verse 36, and she said, Father, if you've made a vow to the Lord, you must do what you have vowed. She did ask her father Jephthah if she could go up into the mountains for 2 months to mourn. Her virginity is what it says, which just simply is talking about the fact she did not have the honor to become a mother. So she didn't have the honor to become a mother. And so she goes up in the mountains for 2 months just to mourn that fact. And then the Bible records for us in verse number 39, her father kept the vow he had made, and she died a virgin. A lot of questions about this, truthfully, that I cannot answer for you. I don't see anywhere in Scripture, where in a godly way, it was common, unfortunately, in satanic ways and in ungodly ways, they would sacrifice children. I've never seen anywhere else in Scripture ever where a godly situation that they sacrificed the child. I know that Abraham was going to, but I want to just point out just a second as a side note here. He told his servants, "I and the lad will be back." That's what Abraham said. He said, "I and the lad will be back." He was willing. I mean, his hand was raised and he was willing, but he knew somehow, hey, if I do this, God's still going to raise him and me and the lad, we're coming back. But I see here in Scripture now a whole lot of questions. I understand that. But here's what I want us to get. Jephthah is not in Hebrews chapter 11 because he was a great warrior. He's not in Hebrews 11 because he was victorious in battle. He is found in Hebrews 11 because he kept his word. He is found in Hebrews chapter 11 because he realized that once he committed to something, he had to stay committed to something. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 5:5 that it is better to say nothing than to make a promise and not keep it. Here's what you and I need to understand. Our society is desperate for somebody to keep their word. Our society is desperate for somebody who is going to live out the faith that they talk about on social media. You see, we'll post this and we'll post that and we'll talk about this and we'll talk about that, but society is desperate. Society is desperate for somebody to live out their faith. Somebody that even when circumstances are bad and they're negative and they are terrible, that they are still willing to live out the faith that they talk about. I had the opportunity yesterday, and God led me to share this before I knew who was going to be here. I want y'all to hear me. I had the opportunity yesterday, and I say opportunity, which sounds really weird when I'm going to share with you what I did. I went to a memorial service. And I went to a memorial service where a young woman lost her life way younger than she should. And I went to this memorial service and to celebrate that life. And 43. And so I go to this memorial service, and as part of this memorial service, and I'm watching a mother, and I'm watching a husband, and I'm watching a daughter, and I'm watching a son, and I'm watching a sister. And in the middle of this, man, I want you to hear me right now. In the middle of this service where a mother was taken way, 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 way too young, I watched in the middle of that service a daughter who was broken literally raise her hands as they were singing worship songs. And I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, man, what kind of faith is that? I can't imagine how I would react. I can't imagine how I would be dealing with that. And I sat there, and with my own eyes, I watched this daughter who was just married like a month ago and all this life in front of her, and now she doesn't have her mother. And I watched her in the middle of that situation raise her hands in faith and praise God because she had a faith that was real. This world is desperate. It is desperate for some Hebrews 11 type of people who will live out their faith even when it's hard and even when it's devastating. My God is still God, and I might not be happy and I might not be content and stuff may just be crappy right now. I still will praise God because He's worthy. That is a real type of faith. Our world is desperate for people who's not going to allow circumstances to change their faith. See, because that's what we really see all around us, right? We see people who will post about their faith. And that's a good thing. That's a great thing, by the way. It's a wonderful tool. But how often, don't respond, but how often do we see somebody who speaks about their faith, who posts about their faith, something negative happened, and man, they're acting like the most ungodly person you've ever seen in the next hour, right? I'm just being real, right? We see it over and over. This world needs some Jephthahs, some people who are willing to say, I made a vow or I made a promise, and I'm going to keep my promise no matter how hard it is. Listen to me, follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, right now. A lot of you have made promises. A lot of you have made commitments to the Lord. And it gets hard. And you have something sucky like 2020 come up and everything's wrong and everything's broken. Let me tell you right now, the world is desperate for some heroes who are going to still live out their faith no matter what is going on around us. They are desperate for some heroes. So that's what we learn about Jephthah. It's not really where I wanted to focus today. However, I thought that that is something that is very, very, very important for us to understand. However, with that being said, now I want to introduce to you here comes the Ready or Not. Here one of the best the tag team. Huh? You with me? Oh, y'all ain't getting it. Huh? Y'all ever watch some of that old stuff and they got their song when they come out and you just want to get up and punch your brother in the shoulder because you're getting all pumped? I'm talking about one of the best tag teams ever recorded in history. And this tag team, they brought the boom to the enemy and they're just like this. They tag back and forth. So we're going to back up a little bit in Judges, actually. But there's another name in Hebrews chapter 11 that it talks about, and that was Barak. How many of you are familiar with Barak? Just curious. Okay. Barak, I love that. I'm glad because they're found in Hebrews 11. Are you with me? Does that mean that they were a giant in the faith? Shake your head yes. This is not a trick question. Yeah. So they're found in Hebrews chapter 11. So I want to explain to you why Barak is in Hebrews chapter 11. And we're introduced to him and his tag team partner in Judges chapter 4, starting in verse 1, here's what it says. After Ehud's death, the Israelites again did evil in the Lord's sight. Now hold on, let me give you a little history. It was 200 years before this that God sent the plagues and miraculously delivered them from being slaves in Egypt. 200 years. Are you with me? And now, I'm just going to be honest, I get a little judgy in my spirit. I'm thinking, how stupid. You and your ancestors for 400 years lived as slaves, and now, 200 years later, you're acting so stupid that God lets an enemy, Canaanite king, take you over, and you find yourself in bondage again. How dumb can you people be? Y'all might not think that, but I'm just sharing what some people think in their judgy spirits. Me. And you know what God reminded me? You know how old the United States of America is? About 244 years old. And I have studied our country enough, and I am so patriotic in just my spirit and my makeup that I study our founding fathers. Do you realize that our founding fathers wouldn't even have the first Continental Congress until they had prayed and fasted for hours? Hear what I'm telling you. They wouldn't even have a meeting. They said, guys, there is no reason to meet unless God is in the middle of this thing. And they fasted and they prayed for days. And when they met, these men, our founding fathers, what they did, they put their fortunes on the line. What they did is that their homes became, they became parts of the enemy. And the enemy would come and they would capture this home. And so then they would send a letter and they said, hey, if you want to keep your house, you better pledge allegiance to the King of Great Britain. And so these men, to their own peril, to their own destruction, would say, I will never, ever pledge allegiance to that tyrant. And their homes would be destroyed. It is recorded for us in history that one of our founding fathers, they captured his son. And they said, if you want your son to live, you better pledge allegiance to the King of Great Britain. And he said, I will never pledge allegiance to the King of Great Britain. And I think about them dedicating their fortune and dedicating their money and even parts of their family. A lot of them died all alone. Their family had deserted them or been killed, and they were broke and they had no money. And I think that is the greatness that it took to birth this country. And then I see what we have 244 years later, and I'm going to try really hard not to be negative politically, but that is not what we have today. Today, we're more concerned about getting into office. And by the way, this happens on either side of the aisle that you're on. We have people that go in, and it was said, I'm trying to be really careful right now, somebody couldn't come and perform their duties in Washington, D.C. when they were first elected because they didn't have enough money to pay rent in D.C. And just a tiny short while later, they're now multimillionaires. We're more concerned about setting our kids up to be successful and setting them up to make a bunch of money than we are about being willing to take a stance and to live out our lives in front of people. We're more concerned about blessing everybody else and then being financially good than we are about the good and the call of what we're called to. And then so now I look at the Israelites and I think, maybe I shouldn't be quite so judgy. Because the United States of America, which by the way is still the greatest country on earth, you better say amen or I'll think something not good. We have faults, amen. But there is no better country, amen. And we need to appreciate where we're at, amen. And we need to appreciate the men and the women who fight for you and I to have the freedom to run our big, fat, stupid mouths while they're at foreign countries fighting for us, amen. So I look at this and I think that here's Israel, and they've again done evil in the sight of the Lord. So I pulled back my judgy spirit, just sharing with you. Verse 2. So the Lord turned them over to King Jabin of Hazar, a Canaanite king. I need your help with this one. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Harosheth Hagoyim. Now, I'm going to say it again. Harosheth Hagoyim. Now, this is going to become so important here in a minute. I want you to repeat after me. Harosheth. Let me say that one again. Harosheth Hagoyim. Okay, that was not a whole lot of conviction there. I'm going to do it one more time. Maybe two. Harosheth. That's better. Hagoyim. Very good. I'll stop after one. So this commander of the army lived in Harosheth Hagoyim, and he had 900 chariots. It says that he ruthlessly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. I want you to catch this part. So he ruthlessly oppresses them, not just oppresses them, but ruthlessly oppresses them for 20 years. The Bible says at the end of verse 3, then the people of Israel cried out to the Lord for help. I'm just going to tell you, I'm not the sharpest tool in the drawer. But it ain't going to take 20 years of oppression for me to figure out this ain't working. Amen. I lived through 2020. Man, I'm desperate. You tell me what to do, Lord. I'm in. I've had enough. And God's people for 20 years were not just oppressed, but they were ruthlessly oppressed. And then after 20 years, they cry out to the Lord. Verse 4, we're introduced to our first tag team hero. Verse 4, Deborah, this is the Old Testament. This is the Old Testament. Deborah, the wife, which means she was a female. Deborah, the wife of Lipidoth, was a prophet who was judging Israel. Now, some of you that may not understand Scripture and history, this isn't striking you the way that it should. In the Old Testament, they treated women in a way that was terrible. I'm just being honest. It was terrible. You were not allowed to be counted in a census. You weren't considered to be worthy of being called in a court of law because you're a woman, and you weren't even, you know, you're not even believable because you were a female. You were just seen, the only thing possibly good you could do was to give a guy a male son. Other than that, there was really no good in you. And so we see in Scripture that here, verse 4, Deborah, a woman, not only was she a prophet, but she was also a judge. And so historically, this is so out of normal that it's unbelievable. But what we see here is that they were living in a time where obviously the Israelites were not living the way they needed to. And there were people that God had called to rise up. And I'm sure there were people that God had called to be prophets. And because they were punk spiritually, they didn't do what they were supposed to. And there would have been people who would have been called to be a judge over Israel. And because they were spiritual punks and they were lazy and they were not focused on what they needed to, they shucked their duties. And so God found somebody, even if society looked at them and said, well, normally you wouldn't work, but we see here that Deborah ends up being one of these tag team partners that does great and mighty things. So here's Deborah, a prophet and a judge. Verse 6. One day she sent for Barak. Barak. Barak, who is a Hebrews 11 type of Barak. So here's the first time that we see the tag. Come here, Miss Abby. I'm reaching out and No, not automatic. Come on, man. She's too young to have seen this stuff. You got to, like, preach. You got to be dramatic. Oh, that's so good. So here's... That's pretty good. Okay. So here's Deborah. She's in the ring, and she's reaching out, and so she hits Barak, and oh, and Barak comes in, right? It's one of them 188 times in 2 seconds. I didn't say 188 the first time, but now it's even better this time. And so here's what we see. That's our first tag. So here we're introduced to our tag team heroes. You have Deborah, a woman who's a prophet and a judge, and then she's tagging in to Barak, and here's what she says. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, commands you. Call out 10,000 warriors from the tribes of Naphtali and Zebulun at Mount Tabor. And I will call out Sisera. Remember, he's the guy from Harosheth Hagoyim. Remember that? That's going to become important. And I'll call out Sisera, commander of Jabin's army, along with his chariots and warriors to the Kishon River. There I will give you victory over him. So here's the prophet. Here's the judge of Israel, Deborah, telling Barak. So verse 8, Barak told her, I'll go, but only if you go with me. Soon as this guy, so come here, Abby, stand up again. You did such a good job last time. Here's Deborah, and she's in the middle of the ring, and she's fighting, and she's reaching. Y'all remember? Oh, they'd make it so dramatic. They'd lean over the rope, and and then, so finally, she tags in Barak, and as soon as she tags in Barak, he said, I ain't going unless you go. And she tags him right back. This is Barak. This is the same Barak that we see in Hebrews chapter 11. And he makes the statement, I'm not even going to go to battle unless you go with me. I want you to hear me. All this is so powerful. I pray the Holy Spirit just burns this into you right now. Here we find a man that does such a thing in his faith that God records him for us in Hebrews chapter 11, and he wouldn't even have went to battle unless he had some tag team partner, unless he had another tag team hero that was willing to encourage him and to support him and to be there for him. We don't read about Deborah in Hebrews 11, do we? But because she was a support because she was an encouragement to somebody else. She grew up Barak until he is found faithful enough to be in Hebrews chapter 11. And I'm telling you, this world is desperate for people who will encourage and to lift up and to partner with somebody else. You may not be the one that's talked about. You might not be the one that is recorded, but you could be the one that tags into a Barak, into a Hebrews chapter 11 type of man or a Hebrews 11 type of woman, and you become instrumental in somebody else being a giant in the faith. This guy call him a punk spiritually makes the statement, well, I ain't even going to go to battle unless you go with me. If I was Deborah, I'd have had a word for him. And here's what she does. Here's what she does, verse 9. Very well, she replied, I will go with you, but you'll receive no honor in this venture, for the Lord's victory over Sisera will be at the hands of a woman. And you know what he said? I don't care. I still ain't going unless you go with me. I give him respect for that. You see, he wasn't in it for the honor. He wasn't in it for the honor. Most of these army leaders at this point would have said, well, if I can't get the honor, I ain't going. And he said, I'm not going. If you don't go, I'm not going. So what's going on there? Another tag. Just stay there. Just reach. You got to reach farther than that.
I'm short.
Second service, I'll find some longer arms over here. And they're a little dramatic, so they'll be all playing it up. Okay. Student section's going to be like, oh, yeah. Okay, I'm just saying. All right. So then she's tagging him, right? She's tagging him back in. Verse 14. Then Deborah says to Barak, get ready. This is the day the Lord will give you victory over Sisera. So here's Deborah, and she tags him back in. You see, he punked out the first time. He got in the ring, and she said, hey, you need to go and do this battle. He said, nope, not unless you go. And he jumped back out of the ring. I don't think he was reaching for a tag. I think he was just sitting there like this, looking around, counting rafters and lights in the arena. And then now you see, once she said, okay, I'll go with you. Okay, I'll support you. Okay, I'll be your encouragement. You see, now at that point, then we see here that Barak led his 10,000 warriors. I want you to get this. It's important. A guy that didn't have the faith, a guy that didn't have the strength to even go unless this woman would go with him. Now God has entrusted to lead 10,000 people. You have no idea the people you're going to influence. You may never be a pastor. You may never be a worship leader. You may never be on stage. You may never teach a class. But you have no idea the Hebrew 11 type of giants in the faith that you're speaking life into. You have no clue those that you're encouraging. She never picked up a sword. Deborah never swipes it at the first enemy, but because she was willing to help and to support and to just be there for somebody else, she was the one that was instrumental in tagging in a giant of the faith that we read about in Hebrews 11. So here we see that Barak is leading 10,000 of the troops. Verse 15. When Barak attacked, the Lord threw Sisera and all his chariots and warriors into a panic. Sisera leaped down from his chariot and escaped on foot. Now, we're talking about Sisera. He was the commander. You with me? You remember? Verse 16. Then Barak chased the chariots and the enemy all the way back to Harosheth Haggoyim. You're not shouting, so you don't get it. Where was Sisera from? That place. Very good. How astute. Verse 2. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Harosheth Haggoyim. Sisera was from Harosheth. Okay. HH. You with me? Yeah, that's better. Harosheth Haggoyim. That's where Sisera was from. Verse 16. Then Barak chased the chariots and the enemy all the way to Harosheth Haggoyim, killing all of Sisera's warriors. Not a single one was left alive. Here's what you need to understand, and I don't think it's burning in your spirit yet. Because Deborah was willing to reach out and tag in Barak, and even when Barak was a spiritual punk, we can say, because he's like, I'm not going into battle, but because each one of them played their part, they took the enemy and they chased him all the way back to where they're from. You and I need to tag in with some of God's people, and we need to chase the devil right back to hell where he belongs, and we need to chase him out of our homes, and we need to chase him out of our marriages, and we need to chase him out of the hearts of our children and out of our community. When you and I partner together, we can chase every demon and every devil back to hell where they belong, out of our churches, out of our spirits, out of our minds. But you and I have to care enough about somebody else to reach out there. I just feel like God is waiting. I'm telling you, I feel like God is waiting. There's some Baraks out there, and there's some Jephthahs out there, and they're discouraged right now. And I believe there might be an addict right now. There might be a drunk right now. There might be a prisoner right now who is broken, and they're devastated, and they just need a Deborah to speak life and to encourage them and to uplift them and to let them see hope in somebody else. You see, we just need to tag somebody else in. You may never, ever be in the public ministry. You may never be in front of people. But maybe all God wants you to do is to just support somebody. Just speak a word of encouragement. Just to speak a word of love. Just to pick them up when they fall. When they do that, when you do that, I read in Scripture where they chase the enemy right back to where they came from. And our society is desperate for the enemy to be chased out of our homes, to be chased out of our community, to be chased out of our state, to be chased out of our country, out of our world, back to hell where he belongs, so that you and I can live the lives of peace and the life of blessing and anointing that God wants us to have. Now here's my question as you stand with me. Are you willing to do your part? Maybe God's going to call you to go to battle. Some of you right now, I feel like with ministry, maybe God's calling you to go to another level. Some of you may never lead a life group. Some of you may never teach a class. You may never be on a stage, have a microphone on you, or be looking into light. Some of you may never do that. But I guarantee you that every single person, every single person that says yes to Jesus Christ has a calling on your life. There is somebody that you need to speak your glorious message into. You need to share your testimony. You need to share what God has done for you. As I read Hebrews 11, I see men who were so drunk that they made horrible mistakes. David is mentioned in there. Here's a man who not only he ended up having an affair, and to cover it up, he committed murder, and God finds him in Hebrews 11. You have people that got so drunk, they were running around naked in the streets, and they're found there. One woman, bless her heart, which Christian means, oh, it's true, but bless her heart, is still recorded as a prostitute in Scripture. And here's what we need to understand. These were not perfect people. These are messed up people. They're people with a past. Jephthah's mom was a prostitute. His own brothers kicked him out of the house. He had to leave the town because he was that guy. But we find because of their faith, not their past, not their skills, not their abilities. Not one name that's mentioned in Hebrews 11 is there because of their skills, their abilities. Everyone says, it was by faith. This world is desperate for some tag team heroes. I feel like God is just reaching out. And you see, our society, they're getting their butt kicked. You with me? Our partners in the middle of the ring. Our society, our community. Some of us, our families are in the middle of the ring and they're just getting their butt kicked. And man, if you and I will just reach out and do everything we can, we're there, we're available, and we got to holler at them sometimes. I remember the Rock and Roll Express, man. Once somebody hit them, that little blonde-head dude would hop over that top rope and he'd bounce off this rope and bounce off that rope and bounce off this rope and then hit him with the clothesline or whatever. And man, soon as you got tagged in, the tides turned. And you see, I feel like God is about to the point, He's ready for the tides to turn, to start bringing back in family members, to start bringing back in a broken community, to start helping those who right now are discouraged and broken. But somebody's got to care enough to be an encourager. Somebody's got to care enough to support them. If you and I were Deborah, today society would be like, I should be in Hebrews 11. Why is he in there? All he did is what I told him to do. And he's in Hebrews 11 and I'm not. You see, if we're about the glory, if we're about the praise, we're not Hebrews 11 type people. So as they sing, I just want you to respond. I want you to be prayerful about who it is, about what it is you need to do, because people are desperate. They're waiting on you to tag in. Turn the tide. We got people all around us that we love, we care about. Mentally, they're getting beat up. Physically, they're getting beat up. Spiritually, they're just being demolished. You and I need to care enough to reach and to just be tagged in so we can come in to be the support they need us to be.
Desperate for your hand, reaching out, we're reaching out, we're reaching out. If we ever need you, Lord, it's now, Lord, it's now. desperate for your hand. We're reaching out. We're reaching out. If we ever needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, it's now. We are desperate for your hand. We're reaching out.
Before we dismiss, I want to read a card. Just says thank you so much. Thank you, Legacy, for all you guys have done for our family. We are forever grateful. We don't know what we would do without you all during this rough patch in our lives. Krista, Derek, Maddie, Bailey, Brenna, Lena, and Nate. For those of you who do not know, we have a, I call her a young woman, she's younger than me. 5 children. Is she still in the hospital? She's been there how long? Okay, so the 17th. She went in on the 17th, right? So Krista has been in the hospital for several weeks already. We'll be there for several more. Got a really rough diagnosis to the point where the kids can't even go see her. They are letting one in, right? They are letting one in the hospital there, but so they're just thanking us for our support. Can you imagine having 5 kids? Several young, right? Not being able to get your hands on them, not being able to just take care of all the things that you feel like you're having to do, and then on top of that, she's there suffering alone, mostly. So we need to continue to pray for that family, but they just want to thank you for their support. Father, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for your word. Thank you for reminding us that we don't have to be something ultra special or out of the norm for you to use us and our faith. Thank you for recording for us that there were men and women who were not perfect that you chose to use in great ways. God, men and women that what they did thousands of years ago still affect us today. I pray that you give us a heart to help, to encourage, to uplift other people. And that as we do that, Lord, that we can impact your kingdom. Help us to be your hands. Help us to be your feet. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.